Hi guys. So a live show. Did a lot of videos the past weeks about preparing for a correction, and I'm happy to answer your questions in this live show about it. I think this should be the main focus for investors today, is to have a plan ready to execute if we indeed see a strong correction that will likely lead to a new bottom and possibly to a very deep bottom. I think that a track record is super important when you judge people's opinions. If you really need to, and that's a lot of work. We all like to avoid that and just like to hire people at face value when it comes to new girlfriends or a new lawyer or a new bookkeeper or a new investment advisor. We all like to take the shortcut and just judge based on the looks and let's go with that. But that's not doing your homework. If you really want to like not waste your time and money, you need to also look at what their past performance was, because that will give you the best indicator of their future performance. And so, well, you're listening to me here, so my track record is of importance. And well, I just shared on Twitter yesterday my biggest investment mistakes. But from that, you can also see that I've been learning. And for example, the past bear market in 2015, I was successful in investing 80% of my portfolio in the crypto market. That was an amazing performance in the last bear market of 2015. Just ask around to all the people that you think are great investors how much they invested in the crypto market during the bear market of 2015 of their portfolio. I made certainly mistakes there, but in the end I did invest 80%, and the bear market before I was not successful in that. I only invested like 20%, so I really learned from my mistake. And in the last bear market I went to 80% successfully, and I hope I can succeed in going even higher in this bear market to 90%, hopefully, exposure. Also, when it comes to the top, it's true, I made a big mistake of not going to a minority exposure at the top, but I did bring it down from about 90% to 70% around the top. And although that's only 20% of my portfolio, that was in fiat a big amount that allowed me to to buy during the bear market. But of course that was not a great performance, and I hope in the next bull market at the top that I will do much better and I will succeed in going to a minority exposure. But today you have to judge the performance in previous bear markets of the people that you follow and how did they do. And I think my track record has been very good there, though I've made big mistakes. Previous bear market, for example, I invested, even though I went to 80% exposure, I did invest the majority of that, like 50% in NXT and only 30% in Bitcoin. And that was a big mistake, because the bear market continued for a small coin like NXT another year, while Bitcoin found the bottom in January at 155. NXT found its bottom 1 year later in December of 2015. At like 2 to 3 times lower than it was in January. So I learned from that not to invest in small coins during a bear market, but only in the biggest coins. But of course, I also believe you really have to invest in something you believe in and not invest in things that you don't believe in. And for me, Bitcoin, BTC is not an option then. And Ethereum, though intellectually I totally agree this is a great investment, and they are going to do very likely very well, my heart is not in it. So the next one up, and Ripple I've never been interested in. For me, Bitcoin Cash is the biggest coin that I really believe in. But there are many other projects that I also like, but they are smaller projects, and so I refuse to invest in them during a bear market. So I think for you guys, it's very important to really prepare a plan here, because what's your plan here? How much are you planning to invest in crypto during this bear market is the most important question you can ask yourself. And for that, you need to look at your total portfolio, your total net worth. I need to put in everything, and also your real estate, your company, if you have a company, like what's the value, the liquidation value of these assets. You put that all in your portfolio, and then you look at the exposure you have to crypto now compared to other assets, and then you look at the risk reward ratio of these assets, and you rank them, like which is the best risk reward ratio investment here. And of course you're gonna end up with seeing that actually crypto is the much better risk reward investment. And then you also have to like make an important decision here, like do you want to make money via investing, or is investing only for you to build security? This is a very important question you need to ask yourself, because for most people investing is only to build security, not to make money. They make money via their own company or their job, and that also means that they very likely will continue to do that for the rest of their lives, because they won't be making money via investing, and that's why most people choose investments that are safe. They don't have a good risk reward ratio, but they are safe, like real estate or a stock market index, and that's true, they are safe on average. You don't lose purchasing power there on average, because it does depend, like there are decades where you do lose a lot of purchasing power, but then there are decades when they go up a lot in purchasing power. So on average, over a lifespan of 40-50 years, yes, you won't lose money there. But you also don't really make money there, because inflation is fooling you. A stock market index makes 7% per year on average. That's true on average, but inflation is 5% per year on average. That's the amount of how prices go up in US dollars or in euros. On average, that's 5%, and people then don't want to face this, but that's the truth. I've made videos on that. You can look it up. I have given all the price histories of many, many goods, services, assets, commodities. Like, yes, it's 5% per year. So that's how most people invest. They just lock away whatever they earn into assets that are safe, but actually they don't make money. And actually, that's probably the case with your portfolio today too. Like, most people have the majority of their capital invested in these assets. Of course, in crypto you do have it's a strange combination, because in crypto these days you also have many people that actually are invested already today 90% or 80% of their total net worth in crypto. But most of these people are young people, and they can afford that because if they lose all that money, they can earn it back in a couple of years. But for the people that are like not 20, but they are like 30 or 40, I'm 40 or 50, most of the people there, and once you start to have some money, you start to become much more risk averse. And that's where I think big mistakes are made. Not with the young people that invest 90%, but they're only 25. That's fine, I think. It's with the older people that have some assets and they choose to invest only 10 or 20% in crypto. I think they can make a very big difference for themselves. Or of course, if you're a young person with some capital, you do the same. Like, it's about not your age, but it's about your portfolio composition. But of course also, what's your target here? Do you want to like make money with investing or not? And so if you want to make money with investing and you don't want to continue running that company or doing that job, you really need to look at your investments from a risk reward perspective and invest according to the Kelly criterion, which is a scientifically proven way to optimize your returns, your profits. It's scientifically proven because there is actually a mathematical formula behind it. You can calculate exactly how much you need to invest based on odds. I don't have the formula by head. I also don't really use the formula, but I do invest in that style, because I'm lazy. I should be using that formula, but basically I simplify it to something that works easier for me, which is like if an investment is double as good, when you look at risk reward, then you should also invest double as much in it, compared to the other one. And then also you're gonna get the right kind of ranges. Huh? And so that means for crypto, actually, like in the long term, this is the best investment by far. And that's true during booms and busts, during overvaluation and undervaluation. In the long term, in both scenarios, this is a great investment. Eh? That's why it's so difficult at the top to sell crypto, because all the bulls and everybody says, in the long term, this will go much higher. And that's true. Huh? That's true even at the top. So in the long term, this is a great investment, and I do strongly believe it is extremely likely that valuations of crypto will go up to at least the valuations of the competing fiat currencies, and that will this will happen over the next 20 years, and that means we're not even at 1 trillion, we're at 100 billion or 200 billion now. Competing currencies have a total value of about 80 trillion, and that's just monopolized government currencies. That's not banking money, because we don't even use the fiat money of the government. Most of our money is banking money, and that's not money, it's credit. Huh? But you can see that just the fiat money, the bills, the few cash bills that you have, huh? And for every person, that's about like only $5,000 in the US economy, in the euro economy is only 5,000 euro. That's the amount of fiat money in circulation per person. Huh? But if you calculate all the fiat money together, that's 80 trillion already. Huh? We are very likely going to achieve that kind of valuation with crypto over the next 20 years. And that's like from here times 5 is 1 trillion and another times 100. Like we're talking about 100x, 500x easily in the next 20 years. So long term, it's a great investment. But short term, it really can differ a lot. At the top. Yeah, long term, that's still true. But short term, we were almost at 1 trillion 1 year ago, 1 year and a half ago. In the short term, it can go down a lot. But this happened already. Huh? We went down from 800 billion to 100 billion, now at 200 billion. So short term, actually, it has become already a very good investment also. So short term as well as long term, crypto is a very good investment today. Very short term, I believe it's still a very bad investment. But that's very short term. We're talking about a couple of months only, huh? Not a couple of years. Huh? So you can see that the risk reward is already very, very good for crypto, and already deserves today a majority exposure in your portfolio compared to your other investments. If the goal is to make money with your investments, huh? And one day maybe be able to live from that and not do the other activities that you do, then that's the way you should invest. And that's really it's a little bit dependent on how much capital you have also, of course, because you only need to cover your living expenses. If you have more capital to play with, you need to make less returns, huh? But actually, if you look at what's the best portfolio composition here from a profit potential, it doesn't matter where you're playing with 10K or with 100K or 1 million or 10 million. It doesn't matter. Your portfolio composition will be the same. If you do the calculation risk reward, it's exactly the same for every asset, independent of how much you put in it. Huh? And so, yeah, today you should have a majority exposure in crypto. I'm convinced of that. And I've been wrong about that. Sometimes I said, no, you should have a big minority exposure. Eh? I start to say that around 5,000, but sometimes I said the majority. But I think I was wrong when I said a big minority. It should have been a majority exposure right there. Huh? Today, I made some mistakes. I'm at a minority exposure. And I do believe you need to correct mistakes when you get a chance, and I didn't get that chance once it started really going up parabolically. But now that the market is very likely going to correct, you really need to set that plan, that buying plan, because the moment it starts to go down, it's very, very bad idea to start making a plan, because you will of course set your prices lower and lower and lower. Huh? The same as when you try to sell and the market goes up and you're gonna create a plan, well, your mind is already set like, oh, this is going up, 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 and your greed is already possessing your mind, and so you always set prices higher and you end up really failing. And so Like, you need to do that today. You need to decide how much do I want to invest of my total capital and at what prices. And you need to set these targets today. And then you will, and then you also have, will still need a lot of strength to execute that plan, because you will get tricked. Like right now, nobody is talking about how low it can go, but the moment it starts to really go down a lot, suddenly you have all kind of scenarios popping up from all the people that you follow why it will go lower, and some of them will be very believable, huh? And so you start doubting your plan, whether it's a good idea, huh? But it's then that you actually need to execute your plan and need to look at the arguments why actually it's not so likely that it will go lower. So let me first take a look at the questions here, since we're doing a live show, and maybe after that I can go another time through the probabilities why I think certain prices will be hit likely and why I think other prices will not be hit likely. But in summary, I'm still sticking to my previous video that you can see easily. I still think that it's very likely that we will see a retest of the bottom, and a retest of the bottom in crypto, you add 30% to the bottom, so 3,150 was the bottom. That means 4K, you have added 30% at 4K. That's very likely we're gonna see that being retested. And that means for Bitcoin Cash, that means $200, and for Ethereum, 150, something like that. Let me take the prices here. I think that's very likely. And I think that's where you also need to correct the mistakes. If you have made any and you're underexposed, that's where you need to do it. It's not 4,000, it's $4,500 for Bitcoin. And it's 140 for Ethereum and 200 for Bitcoin Cash. I think these are very important prices, because they also, it will also would mean we would actually, we would also be going to a minus 50% undervaluation again, compared to the trend line. And I think that's also very likely to happen. As in previous bear markets, undervaluation has always come back and gone up, even if the bull market started. Always, even when the bull market started, you did see that undervaluation go up over time. And so we saw 50% minus. We will probably see it again, and that would mean we will see these prices. But this is, like, I think still very likely to hit. But it may certainly be the last chance, because if the bull market started, we will go up from there again, and that will have been the last time that we saw those prices. Maybe we'll see it again a little bit later, but it, probably a little bit higher. And so you really need to correct your mistakes there. If you haven't gone to a majority exposure, that's where I think you really need to do it. Let me go to the questions now, but in summary, yeah, that's the most important thing here. And that's for me, because I already have like 45% exposure. I will then go to 70% exposure. But if you only have like bought 10 or 20% of what you intended to do, or you only have like a 10% exposure, and you also want to go to a majority exposure, you can't wait for such price. You have to build another buy-in target somewhere between the prices I mentioned and the higher prices we've seen. I would then say go to 35% undervaluation, and that will be about 5,500 for Bitcoin, and for Bitcoin Cash it will be 260, and for Ethereum it will be 200. So I think this level is also important, because it's more likely to hit. I think it's extremely likely to hit, but it's if you are really underexposed, you should really like start going to a majority there. Or at least make up half of what it means to go to majority. So let me look at the questions here, and I'll only pick the interesting ones. So please do ask interesting questions. So when you bottom, I think it's supposed to happen around the middle of the year here. So that's in next month, but it could be months later also. It could have been months sooner too. And it's not important. It's not important when exactly. But of course, if it doesn't happen over the next, I would say, in the summer and in September, we're still at higher prices. We haven't reached these prices yet. Then the odds that we saw the bottom in December 2015 go up. And so then the plan needs to be adjusted. But for now, it's likely to happen over the next few months. So I never go short in crypto. I think going short is very, very dangerous for an asset that goes up so much over time. Even at the top, yes, you should go short, but it can always go higher. And going short is an instrument where you lend something from someone, and so you will have to give it back too. And if that's what you're playing with, that's dangerous. Also, inflation is working against you when you go short. You see this in the stock market so often. In the stock market, if something goes up much, much, much slower, and even there, people get killed with going short all too often because inflation is 5%. So you're working against that over time. The stock market goes up a lot, but it's not profit, it's just inflation. But as a short, that works against you. Also, as a short, it's an instrument where you borrow money from some, you need to pay interest on that. So all these things add to a short. So I don't think that's the good way to invest. I think a much better way to invest is actually go long only. And especially in crypto, that will allow you to make a lot of money. But of course, you want to like go long with a lot of capital during a bear market, and then bring it down a lot, and basically go out of the market for most of the capital, but not everything, around the top. But that's very difficult, but it's possible. Yannick has 15% exposure, and he's asking, should I sell it now? No, you should not sell a 15% exposure to crypto. I have a 45% exposure. No, like I was wrong to sell half of my crypto around Bitcoin Cash, around $300. I was 80% exposed. I brought it down to 40%, and it was a mistake. Why? Because during a bear market, you should never sell crypto. The only thing you should be doing is buying crypto in steps on the way down. And if you're wrong and you bought too soon, you still need to keep it because, well, in the long term, it's a great investment. And trying to trade, that has been a much bigger loss of opportunity cost. Like so many people, me included, have sold crypto during a bear market for a small profit. And that has been the worst, worst, worst thing you could have done. So you should never sell crypto during a bear market. You should only be buying and stashing. That's my investment strategy. So that's what I would recommend to others too. Let's see. It feels so unlikely that we will see a new bottom. What makes you feel so sure? Yeah, as I mentioned in my videos, it's just that always I apply this in investing, but also to people, that the odds for history, that past performance will be repeated or higher, or past trends or past patterns, the odds for them to repeat are higher than that you get a new pattern. And this is very important to apply. And typically, the knowledge shared about investing by governments or the mass market or the masses is just plain wrong. It's actually the inverse. So what you will see is that governments will obligate anyone that gives any financial advice to say this phrase when they do so. Past performance does not guarantee future performance. And you could say that's true. It does not guarantee future performance. That's true. But what's also true is that past performance is the best indicator of future performance. And that's so important. Like, But you do have to take into account that you have cycles of booms and busts. But so past patterns of crypto has been that the cycles have become longer over time, and so very likely this will continue in the future. There's a very good explanation for that. The market cap goes up over time, so yes, cycles, that's likely the reason why cycles become longer over time, because market cap goes up, so it becomes much more difficult to tenfold and tenfold and tenfold again in such a short time. No, it takes more time because you need more capital and more people to do so. And that's just why I believe that this bear market will take longer than a previous one. And so we're in a way lucky to have seen a bottom in December already of 2017, the same year, 18, the same year that we saw the top in January 2018, we had already a bottom in the same year of December, 11 months later. But that was so unlikely that the bear market is over already, because it's supposed to last 1 year and a half. So we're lucky in a way that it happened so soon, because it's so far from our target. So that's just one indicator, but many others. Please rewatch my previous video. I make a very good case there, ready for the bust or ready for the dump. Please watch that video. I give you all the indicators that I think why the bottom is not in. When will we have all-time highs repeat? I don't focus on that now, because we're in a bear market. It's about buying crypto and stashing crypto. Once the bear market is past, we can start to focus on where the top will be and how high it will be. It's really not so important right now, and it's also an obvious question. It will be much higher, and it will take but it will take a lot more time than in previous bull markets. So somewhere in 2023, 2024 that we'll see the peak, but it goes parabolically, which means that it's the last year, the last 2 years, that will go up a lot. Not till 2022, it will move very, very slowly, following the trend line, which is going more and more horizontal over time. So that's the future ahead, very likely. Let's see what else we have as interesting questions. Yes, this is a great time to sell all kind of assets that you have, and also prularia, like things you don't use. It's always good to clean up your house and just toys you have. And I really like less is more. It keeps not only your house clean, but also your mind. Because everything you own, you have to take care of, and it costs you very valuable time. So it's a great time to sell these assets. It also takes so much time. I can recommend, for example, I have never used it, but there is a Facebook marketplace to sell crap that seems to work much better than eBay. Yeah, things like that, very important. Because this all takes time, and you want to have the fiat ready to buy a crypto bottom. I did buy my only buy during the bear market has been buying Bitcoin Cash at $250. Since then I haven't bought any, and I sold half of that, sadly. No, not half. Yes, of my total amount, I sold half, sadly, at 300, but I still have half left, and I still tripled the amount of Bitcoin Cash, or the amount of crypto I have in this bear market. So I think that's very well done at that price, because you have to know that the bear market, so many people believe that it would stay above 6,000. And for Bitcoin Cash, it would stay above 400. And it was a difficult time to wait for it to finally break. And it did happen, and I did do my buy. And I'm certainly not going to sell anymore, no matter how high we go in the short term. Someone says that I'm getting really desperate. I'm posting every day. No, I don't feel desperate. I just... in life, sometimes you feel productive, sometimes not. Sometimes you feel motivated, sometimes not. And I really feel motivated these days to share what I'm doing and to help other people make the right decisions. Hi, Charles. Great to hear you from the Philippines. Enjoy the beautiful islands there. Let's see. A green Mitzi who has been following my work a long time says, Mark, you are sounding like you did in 2017 when we hit 100 billion. Many people say that I made a big mistake. Sometimes I say that about myself, but actually I don't think that's the case when I look back on it. I did become bearish in the middle of 2017 when Bitcoin went to 3,000. I thought the top was in at 2,800, and then it corrected to 2,800, and then it went back to 2,200, and I decided to go to a minority exposure, and I ended up selling half my crypto there too. It was alts only. I didn't invest in Bitcoin anymore at the time. And have never done since then. I'm out of Bitcoin, but I do invest in alts and at the time too. And I sold half of them and I went to minority exposure, and then Bitcoin went back up and breached the 2,800 and went back to went to a new high of 5,000, and I realized I was wrong. And I went back into the market with majority exposure, and I didn't buy Bitcoin, I bought back alts. Other alts, I liquidated alts I didn't like, I bought new alts, and that's when I bought a big position of Bitcoin Cash and Obit. And I also made a mistake there to pledge to go to do the HODL strategy from there on and never to sell them. But actually the prices I paid for that Bitcoin Cash and Obit was about the same price that I sold, well, that alts were when I went to minority exposure. And alts didn't go up over that summer. It was only Bitcoin that went up. So yes, I went to minority exposure. Yes, I was wrong about calling the top, but I corrected it when it breached. I said I was wrong, and I went to majority exposure again. And that's not a big mistake. It's not. It's being wrong temporarily about the market, admitting it, and then making sure you don't pay the price, making sure you get your position back. And that's exactly what I'm planning to do today. With the mistake I made of selling off the majority exposure. I'm planning to correct that. And I'm picking a scenario that I think is very likely to happen. It's just testing the bottom. Show me a bear market where the bottom has not been tested. It's very likely to be tested. I have my buyers for Bitcoin Cash at 200. And if I would be buying Bitcoin, I would set them at 4,500. These prices or a lot higher than the bottom. The bottom for Bitcoin Cash was 75. If I buy at 200, it's still a double, almost triple the price that the bottom was. So that's a high price still, relatively. Even though we're at 400 now or 350 now. This guy's gone up a lot and it's likely to correct. Same for Bitcoin. Even when valuations were a lot lower for Bitcoin in the previous bear market, the bottom was $155. Valuations were a lot lower. You needed a lot less capital to get out of the bear market. But still, it took quite some time, and it went to $300, and then it went back to $230. No, it went to $350 and to $230 and back to a newer high, almost $400. Wow, we're in the bull market, back to a new low of $200, lower than the previous low. And that took like almost 3/4 of a year, 9 months, and only then it broke out and it went to $600 and the bear market was finished. So these were corrections, even at small market caps that went close to the bottom, like 30% higher. 4,500 is 30% higher than 3,100. So that's very likely to hit them. Even if the bull market has started. Let's see at the other questions. Now, the biggest mistakes I've made, I shared on Twitter. And that was being underexposed when I entered Bitcoin with only 10% of my portfolio in 2011. 12, sorry. when Bitcoin was $13. That was a big mistake. And why was it a big mistake? Because I knew the risk reward was much better for Bitcoin than for my other investments. At the time was gold and gold mining stocks. I knew that. Because yes, I was very unsure that Bitcoin will succeed. It was a market cap of 100 million at the time. Huh? And the climate was very different about Bitcoin. This was a very high risk investment at the time. But I knew that even if it's proves to fail, even if the software fails and suddenly there's massive inflation or something, huh? Or even if the government decides to arrest the lead developers and imprison them, like this was all a risk at the time. Even then, this story is so strong. Now, even if they make it illegal, especially if they would make it illegal, this just by becoming in the news, it would go up from a market cap of 100 million to 1 billion. That was very likely to happen, even if the project would fail. Huh? I knew that. And still, I decided to invest only 10% in it. That was a mistake, because if you have like a 90% probability to do a tenfolding, and then you have other investments where there is just no chance it will tenfold. And this was a short-term play, actually, because it will likely tenfold over the next few years. Whereas gold, that was my biggest investment, and I chose to keep it as my biggest investment. No chance it would tenfold in a couple of years. But at the time, I was wrong. I thought we were still in a bull market of gold. But even then, it would take like 5 years at least, even if I was right, that it would tenfold. And it was a long shot also. Huh? So because there was already a bull market that has lasted 11 years at the time, from 2000 to 2011. So like it was clear to me the risk reward was much better than Bitcoin, but I still decided to invest only 10%. That was the biggest mistake. And I made again that mistake later, a little bit less, but again, in 2013, after the first bubble, I was only 20% exposed because I thought the bear market has just started. We just saw a big bull market. The bear market has just started. There's no chance we get another bubble here in Bitcoin. So I scaled down my exposure from like 50% or so to 20%. And then the new bubble starts. And that was the second biggest big mistake. Like being underexposed has been my big mistake. And in my early days, and almost everybody makes that mistake. Why? Because we don't have the trust in the new investment. We don't have the confidence. And that's why we only take a small step. But intellectually, it's the wrong move. It's understandable that we make that mistake. But if you think about it, it's the wrong move. You have to try to be as rational as possible when you invest. So let's see what else we have as questions. So people think I'm greedy, or bears are greedy to want to try to have lower prices, and some people make very good case of that, and they always use the best case they use is that long term the risk reward is still so good of Bitcoin today and other cryptos, Bitcoin Cash, so why risk being left behind? And that's true, and that's why I always say, yeah, how much exposure do you have now? That's very important. If it's 0%, sorry, but I think indeed it's not worth it, the risk you're taking. But in my case, it's 45%. I'm not risking to be left behind when I have half of my portfolio invested in crypto. But you do get risk behind, risk being left behind. If it's only 10% that you invested, or only 10% of what you plan to invest, yes, then you do risk it. But if it's already half or 40%, yes, it will be a bummer that you didn't invest the other half, but you did a good job. Like this, if you invested half, it will very quickly become a very big position in your portfolio once the bull market starts, and you will go easily to 90% plus exposure by just not selling it. So I don't think I'm taking here a risk. What I personally think is that those that are already invested 80-90% are taking a risk here. Because it's still likely we're gonna make a new bottom. And if you're overinvested before that happens, then very likely you will make very big mistakes when it happens. I made that mistake with NXT. Yes, I invested 80% in crypto during the previous bear market, but the majority in NXT, and it lasted a lot longer than I expected the bear market there. And it shocked me how much I lost by buying on the way down and keeping on buying and seeing it just basically evaporate. And I was very disciplined in continuing to buy, and so I had a very big amount of NXT. But once the bull market started again, I was very quickly to diversify, way too quickly. And why? Because I had overinvested, huh? And that's the risk you're taking when you invest too much, and then it goes down. You probably will go through a tremendous emotional roller coaster. You won't be able to buy anything more, eh, because you're overinvested. So you won't be buying at lower prices. Everybody saw I just made that mistake also during the bear market. I went to from 20% exposure or 25% exposure suddenly to 75% exposure when Bitcoin Cash reached $250. But that was too big of a step, and as a consequence, when it dropped deeper than I expected, I froze. I didn't buy any more. As it went down to 200, 150, 100, 75, I didn't buy anything because I froze. I was sitting on tremendous losses. And so I didn't make the good might move to buy more, and I ended up selling a big stash the moment by being already invested for so much in crypto, huh? Because the odds are against them, huh? The odds are, in my personal opinion, I would say maybe 60% or 70% chance we see a new bottom, huh? And only 30% chance that we don't see a new bottom. But then we still see a retesting of the bottom, which is also a serious correction from here, huh? So I think personally they are taking the risk here. Eh? They don't take the risk of being left behind. That's how it looks. But actually, by the actions that they take, they do take a very high risk to lose money and to make very big mistakes when we see serious corrections or a new bottom. All right. What else do we have? Yes, a very good idea to set your sell and buy plan to the overvaluation chart of Trololo that I also use. I think it's a very good guidance. Someone says he plans to sell here if we get 50% overvaluation. If you get 300, 400% overvaluation, he plans to sell half. And that's exactly going to be my plan. But yeah, that's for far away. I think today the focus needs to be on buying, and I think in the crypto market most people make the mistake thinking the bull market has started. I think that's gonna be the biggest differentiator for your future returns, huh? Because those that believe that the bull market has started today are not preparing even for a serious correction, but certainly not for a new bottom, and I do think this is most likely. The investment advice, don't invest more than you can afford to lose, I think is wrong. This is the typical approach to invest to see investing as to build security and only that. Yeah, then you can say only invest what you can afford to lose because your goal of investing is to build up security. So yeah, if you put in real estate, you're not gonna lose it, or in a stock index fund, I mean, much less chance to lose it. And so from that perspective, many say, okay, let's risk 10% of my portfolio in crypto. Eh? That's the only thing I'm willing to lose. But this is not trying to optimize your returns. Eh? This is not the way you should approach it. Eh? When you approach it from a risk reward perspective, you actually end up allocating the most to crypto and not the least. And I think that's the right way if you want to make as much profit as possible. And actually, I think that that also creates the biggest security because you will become more richer over time, much more richer over time than someone who does not do that. And that builds much more security, real security, in my opinion, eh? When you become richer over time, your confidence builds, your security builds because you have many more assets. You get much more free time, much more power over your life to do whatever you want. You don't get this when you are approaching investing from a fear, approach, fear of losing. You're just gonna keep what you have in best case. And you're not gonna really grow. And so the security you built, yes, it's some kind of security, some kind of like savings that you can eat as you become older. Yes, you can like gonna have to start selling some real estate because your living expenses are higher than your income. So, but then you have less and less money over time. So you, the insecure feeling stays there. Whereas if you just like try to take opportunities where you see them and study markets and be willing to risk, but it's not really risking because the risk reward you can see is much better than the other investment. You're just going to grow richer over time. That's a better approach. It's only in the later years when your mind starts going down that you're not going to be so good anymore in analyzing the market and you're going to start making mistakes. You misjudge the risk-reward ratios. You end up betting too much on something and losing a lot. Like that's when you really need to start scale down indeed and take less risk because your mind is not able to do it anymore. But then still you can imply these things, but you just take less risk. But it's still the right approach then to risk more on an opportunity that is there than on something that where there is no opportunity. Yes, you won't lose it, but there is no opportunity to make money. Like still in your old days, you can apply that. You just bet less of your total portfolio on an opportunity. Let's see at the other questions. Which cryptocurrency are you most bullish on? I also mentioned in the biggest investment mistakes I made that it was in the bear market of 2015. I did not invest in I only invest in NXT and then in Bitcoin, and then later on I invested also in Clumps, but that was it. But I did study the other opportunities like IOTA. I was very close to invest in the ICO, a big amount. Ethereum, I was very close to invest in the ICO, and then also very close later on when the ICO was launched already to invest in it. But I was always like for IOTA, I didn't invest because of the track record of the founders. They were actually the founders of NXT and then they left via the back door and they started IOTA. So for that, even though I missed a great opportunity there financially, I would have sold it off very quickly because I lost trust in the founders. And so even though that was like 1000x investment, I would have never made that because I didn't have the trust in the founders. But I could have made easily 10x on a big investment in the early bull market and diversified into other investments. It would have made a big difference. So even I think like when the bull market starts, you should be not so strict as I have been in the past and not so difficult and not so selective in investing in projects. You can basically invest in anything because sooner or later one of those things, even stupid projects, will pump a lot and then you just sell it. Like that was a big mistake, to be very selective and invested, but also like I picked the wrong projects. I was really looking for the next thing in crypto after Bitcoin was a success, and I thought it's financial assets. It's going to be stocks and bonds on the blockchain. And so NXT was the first one to have operational software and that works and used proof of stake system. It looked very nice, very good, usable. And so that's why I chose NXT. But NXT lost the race totally to Ethereum, who was a competitor. And I chose never to invest in it because I didn't believe in the approach. The approach was there was no operational software. There was a lot of networking going on, a lot of speeches going on by Vitalik, a lot of ideas and vision, but nothing that you could use. And so that's why I never went for it. But I was wrong, totally wrong. And I learned from that I really overvalued just operational software and real adoption. I overvalued that over vision and network capabilities, and most importantly, inspiring other developers to build on top of your platform. NXT really failed there, and really, even the people that they attracted to build on their platform, that they made changes to the software, and they chased away half of the developer community at one point, and that's when I realized, like, damn, eh? And that's why I diversified out of NXT into other cryptos, but I also diversified a piece into startups and crypto companies, and that was also a very big mistake in the early bull market to diversify cryptocurrencies into crypto companies or fiat companies. That's the worst thing you can do, because they will go up a lot less, even if they are crypto companies, even if they are crypto exchanges that are booming in value. Crypto exchanges also, like, yes, you have some of them that are real winners and they win the market in the next bull market, but that's rare. Most crypto exchanges fail or don't exceed in really growing the way the crypto industry is growing, the way cryptocurrencies are growing in market cap. And so all these investments are not a good idea unless you are very, very much invested in one coin. Then you also need to invest in some companies that are pushing that coin, some infrastructure that is building around that coin. You have to do that, but you will do it only with a small part of your portfolio, because the main goal is still to see the value of your cryptocurrency go up, the way Roger Ver does it. He's heavily invested in Bitcoin in the beginning, but he also invests a smaller part into Bitcoin companies, all kind of Bitcoin companies, because it's needed to build the ecosystem. But he still makes sure that his cryptocurrency is the main investment, and the goal is always to see the value of the cryptocurrency go up. And he's doing the same today with Bitcoin Cash. That's the right approach. If you're going to invest in companies, do it like that. Let me go back to where I left off. I made the big mistake to invest way too much in NXT and not in others, and therefore my returns are a lot lower than some people expect. And it is true to that. I could have had much higher returns if I would have picked the winner instead of the loser. But for example, what do I regret? Do I regret not investing in IOTA? No, because I didn't have much belief in it. I would have sold quite quickly. Also, it would have, even though I would have made more money, it would have been a bigger headache too. And I probably would have missed other opportunities that I did later. For example, later, I did go in many altcoins early 2017. I sold all my Bitcoin and I did make very good money there. Like, these moves I would not have made if I did the move to invest in the ICO of IOTA, for example, because I would have been happy about myself and I would have not investigated markets deeper. But for example, I do regret not investing in Ethereum, because Ethereum has continued to be a strong project. And if I would have invested at any point there in Ethereum, I would probably not have sold it. I would have kept it, and I would have seen that 100x or 1000x. Because, yes, my belief was never strong in it, but the moment you put down money, you start to research it more, and I would have discovered then also that it is a strong project. I was also making a mistake, because from the start, Ethereum was very popular among Bitcoin maximalists, and I really didn't like that. But actually, they proved to be right about that one. Not the extreme Bitcoin maximalists, but the wide Bitcoin community at the time. For example, you had Let's Talk Bitcoin, a popular podcast at the time, was talking a lot about Ethereum, but for example, never about NXT. And I was very frustrated about that. This also kept me from not investing in Ethereum. That was a mistake. So I made that mistake. And so for today, many people think I'm making the same mistake by investing in Bitcoin Cash, but not in anything else. And yeah, what can I say? It's certainly possible that I will repeat my mistake by investing in the wrong coin. That's true. We'll have to see what the future brings there. I believe that I will be right. And I believe that Bitcoin Cash will become a much bigger than it has been in the past bull market. But I could be wrong. And I have to say that We'll see. I don't believe in the buy and hold strategy. It's the same as HODL. And we all know today that HODLing is not a good strategy. But HODLing is the same as buy and hold. And I've fought the buy and hold strategy for decades, because you see it also in the traditional investment world. When it comes to real estate investors or stock index investors, they all promote the buy and hold strategy. And it's just not a good strategy, because even if you invest in something as secure as the real estate or stock index, there are decades when it goes up a lot in purchasing power, and there are decades when it goes down a lot in purchasing power. Not in fiat value, not so much, but in purchasing power, yes, because you also count for 5% inflation. Then you see that you can, like with real estate and stock indexes, based on the economic climate, when you're in a boom times, yes, you increase your purchasing power like what, treble, quadruple. Even after 10, 20 years, you can tenfold your purchasing power in these assets. But there are every time there you will have also after 30, 40 years, or after 20, 30 years, 10 years to 20 years of a bad economic climate, where you will lose 80% of your purchasing power in these assets. So that's the case there. But it's in every investment the case that it goes to boom and busts. And so, and not only that, so I don't believe in HODLing. I was wrong to start promoting and doing HODLing, and I will not do that again in my life. It's just wrong. You always have to look at risk reward ratios, and they change as prices go up or down. Risk reward ratio has gone up a lot for crypto now, so it deserves a much larger exposure now that the bear market has chopped off 80-90% of its value. No, actually, it just went up a lot, so we're not at that valuation anymore, but we still are clearly in a bear market, and so a larger exposure is justified. But also, if you look within projects, HODLing is very unwise, because projects change. It all depends on how it's managed, and this changes with the people that come and go in a project. And even if you're in a booming industry, you can make you can really miss the boat by investing in the wrong companies or in the wrong coins. It happened in the internet bubble. It happened in the crypto industry already so many times. Just look in CoinMarketCap at the history under tools history. You look at past valuations, so you can see them there starting 2012 or so at the top 10. What was the top 10 then? What was the top 10 a year later? Top 10 a year later, projects come and go, and it's actually very rare for a project to stay in the top 10. Even in crypto, it's not easy. And there is a strong case to be made to invest also in a crypto index, and that's also my plan. I go now fully focused on Bitcoin Cash, but the moment Bitcoin Cash, the bull market has started, and Bitcoin Cash gains back its market share that it has lost, because it used to be like 20% market share of Bitcoin BTC, now it then went down to like only like 20% of Bitcoin. It peaked out even at 50%. Half the Bitcoin BTC value was Bitcoin Cash during the bubble at the peak, or 40%. But it's been a long time at 20%. But now it's only at 3%, 4%. So the moment the bull market starts, very likely some big coins will pump, have their pump independent from each other. Ethereum will have one, Bitcoin Cash will have one, Bitcoin BTC will have one. Ripple will have one, like Litecoin will have one, independent from each other. Dogecoin will have later one, and the smaller ones, Dash, Monero, will also have one, independent from each other. And when you have a big position in such a coin, it's very smart to diversify when your pump coin finally pumps. And that's my plan. When Bitcoin Cash finally has its pump sooner or later and goes to like 10%, 20% of the value of Bitcoin is again more fairly valued, in my opinion, I will diversify very likely into a crypto index fund, or a not index, I don't like index, but there is this fund that I really like. It's called Cyber Capital on Google, run by Justin Bonds. And he has proven to have very good returns in the previous bear market of crypto. He followed the average returns of crypto, the crypto industry, and that's a challenge for a fund. Huh? But at the same time, he's a value investor, and I believe in that. I don't like indexes because they buy all kind of crap that I don't believe in, and that will very likely lose ranking. But of course, they also buy the new coins that come into the top 10 or come into the top 50. They end up buying those too. But I really believe that in the long term, it does. But it's not an easy task, but it makes a lot of sense to buy value instead of an index. And so a fund like that, they have 50 coins, but they do buy value, huh? And they do switch exposure based on what they see as undervalued, and they do sell coins that they see as overvalued, and they do look at fundamentals, how is a coin, its business model, how is its adoption, all these things matter. And yes, I plan to diversify into a fund like that once Bitcoin Cash pumps. Because yes, I can be wrong about Bitcoin Cash and it can fail. But even if it fails, it will very likely still have pumps in the meantime. Let's see what other questions we have. Do you still have your Byte Ball, now called Obyte? Yes, I do. I do. I also still have Bismuth. These are the two coins that I have next to Bitcoin Cash. But I didn't buy any more on the bear market. And we'll have to see how that goes for the future. Huh? The earliest point I would be willing to invest more in smaller coins is after we have finished the sideways movement that I expect to be till 20. It depends when the bottom was. Huh? But if we make a new bottom, it will be till 2022. If the bottom was in December, the sideways market will be till 2020, the end of 2020. That's another 1 year and a half. And only then I plan to invest, diversify my Bitcoin Cash that will, in the meantime, very likely have a pump somewhere into other crypto projects. But I personally like much more the idea of just investing in a managed fund instead of me investing more in other coins, because I really want to focus on Bitcoin Cash and making it happen for that coin. And so I want to start focus on investing also and building companies around that coin and not being invested in other coins and have to follow that up, all that. So I think that for the future, I will just diversify via a managed fund and not invest myself anymore in other coins. I call it the Rogerverse style of investing. He has been the most successful investor in the crypto industry. The most successful investor. People don't even recognize that, but that's true. And you have some others. Olivier Janssens has done very, very well too, but is not known at all. But I recommend to follow his Twitter because he's one of the very few that invested big in Bitcoin and then later invested big in Ethereum in the early days. For example, Roger Ver failed to do that. He always invested in Bitcoin and he didn't. Of course, he diversified in some other coins, but for a small amount of his capital. It's my impression that Olivier Janssens has invested big also in Ethereum. And so that's the only that one that I know that succeeded in that. So these are people with track records. And if you look at what they do, is they really built a coin. And so that's really what I hope to do in the future too. Help make a coin a success. And that means you can only focus on one coin, really. Maybe two, but more. It's really not possible, I think. Let's see at the other questions. So about the volume, I mentioned in the videos that the volume is low. Check my Twitter. I made also yesterday a tweet where I got that volume, and the short is made by you have the link there. It's another Twitter person. I think it's Cryptomedius, and you can see where he has the volume from. It's from a combination of Bitstamp, Kraken, Coinbase. He adds all those volumes, and that's how he draws his volume chart. That's not the way CoinMarketCap does it. It includes the volumes from stupid exchanges that claim to have the highest volume. You never heard their name. It's just fake volume. It's so obvious. So you wouldn't, why study CoinMarketCap volume? It's just a waste of time. You look at the reputable exchanges that don't publish fake volume and you take you add their volumes. That's how he does it, and that's how you get like realistic, like correct, like truthful numbers. Huh? It can still be wrong numbers, but it's probably much more truthful than the ones on CMC. Huh? Let's see. Peace, click the like buttons, guys. 116 people in the chat and only 28 likes. Please click the likes. It helps to promote the video. YouTube will show it to more people. And yeah. Let's see what else we have. Yes, why are many people not acknowledging throw away his charts where he clearly shows that the NVTS, the NVT is flashing red, showing that we are very likely going to get a strong correction similar to the tops of the bull market in 2017 and 2013. The NVTS shows flashing red like it was then. Why do people ignore that? That's a very good question. And it's always like that. It's the same the other way around. I mean, and I was also guilty of it. When these indicators are flashing green, are you buying? Because I was not buying when they are flashing green, for example. I mean, in the recent bottom, it's just that market psychology is so strong, and that's why we tend to like only want to see what we want to see. And so, if there's evidence that shows that you're wrong, let's not watch that. Let's follow the people that confirm our bias, and it's a mistake we all make. But it's yeah, you become better if you force yourself to really like try to be as rational as possible, and it's very difficult. But if somebody strongs a strong point of evidence that goes against your opinion, yeah, it's very difficult, but that's what you need to do. You need to see it, acknowledge it, and change your opinion based on it. And this is a challenge for so many, for everyone. If you can do that, you're gonna become rich. And not many people become rich, especially not via passive investing. Eh? It's the same as anything in life. It's much easier to give in to your emotions. Eh? Like you feel hunger, you eat. You feel stress, you eat some more. Huh? You're bored, let's eat some more. I mean, in the short term, it does solve your problem. It makes you feel good again, but you do become fat from it. But it's the easy way out. It's the same with investing. People are bullish, let's buy. People are bearish, let's sell. It's the immediate emotion. Satisfying the immediate emotion in the short term feels good in the short term. In the long term, it gives you terrible results. And it takes actually a lot of discipline not to give in to the short term emotions that you feel. It's difficult not to eat. I have a strong time with that. Like, I love eating. Huh? It's so difficult to lose weight because I have to constantly like not do what my short-term emotion wants me to do. It's difficult. Huh? And it's the same in investing. Let's see what other interesting questions we have. Yes, it's especially difficult to not do it a little bit, but a lot. Huh? Like, when the market is screaming, sell, this is a terrible investment, we have lost so much money, look at the fundamentals, everything is collapsing, the amount of users, the amount of YouTube channels posting about it, like the amount of, like, it's like the industry is dying, there's so much bad news, people, exchanges going broke, new regulation, like everything is screaming, sell, get out, and it's exactly then that you have to buy, and not buy a little, but buy a lot, risk your future on it. That's the move you need to take, and it's very difficult. Eh? That's why this video today is about preparing for the bear market. Eh? Make your investment plan today, because even if you make it today, it will be very hard to execute it when the time is there to do it. What's your strategy if you don't see a new bottom? When would you get in? Well, that's the first scenario, huh? When that's retesting the bottom. If we don't see a new bottom, it's still very likely we're going to retest it. And that means it's like 20-30% higher than the bottom. So that's my backup plan. I mean, it's not a backup plan. It's my first plan. That's where I will buy first, assuming that the bull market has started. That's where I buy first. That's where I correct my mistake and go to a majority exposure. But let's say we don't even reach that. Let's say we get a weak correction that does not reach the 4,000 level, but it only goes to like 5,500. I'm being left behind. Okay, I still have like 45% invested. That's fine. But still, I think it's still extremely likely that we will see 50% undervaluation compared to the trend line sooner or later. But it will probably be later, and it will probably be at higher fiat valuations. But that's still very likely, even if we only see a typical correction of only 30% from the top, and we go from 8,500 was the peak, we do a 30-35% correction, we will only go to 5,500, and then the bull market continues, the strong bull market continues, where we don't see a retesting of the bottom. It's very rare, but there is a small chance it happens. Even in that scenario, we will very likely not stay in overvaluation compared to the trend line, because this is exactly what happened in 2011. In 2011, we had a strong correction to from $30 to $3. We went back to $10, back into overvaluation, and the bull market has started. We would not ever get close again to $3. But we did go back to minus 50% undervaluation compared to the trend line, because actually it went up from $3 to $15, and then it went back from $15 to $8, much higher than the bottom. But $8, since the trend was going up so much at the time, was again 50% undervaluation and was the second buy-in point. Okay, you missed three, but if you follow the way of investing that I apply here, is you follow undervaluation compared to the trend line. Yes, you will very likely see 50% undervaluation, but it can take another half year, another year, maybe at much higher fiat prices, but you will get that strong buy signal again, that it's relatively underpriced quite a lot, and so it's a good buy again, and that's my backup plan. And it's a great backup plan, because it's very likely to happen, even if the bull market has started. Let's see at the other questions. Let's see. Did you get any Bitcoin Cash from the fork? Yes, Bitcoin Cash, BSV forked off Bitcoin Cash. I sold all my BSV for Bitcoin Cash at a relatively good price. I was able to add 60% to my Bitcoin Cash holding. So I am very grateful for Bitcoin SV. To allow me to increase my Bitcoin stash with 60%, but it was before I started buying during the bear market, actually at the same time that all happened. So after that, I still tripled my Bitcoin Cash thanks to buying at 250. Let me see at the question here. If you have good questions, please post them. Yes, this halving argument, I'm so bored of it, because it's if you just look at the history of the cycles, you can see that the halving is not the one that makes the cycles. It's not. The halving is every 4 years. But the cycles are not every 4 years. The first cycle was 1 year bull market, half year bear. Second cycle, 2 year bull markets, 1 year bear. Third cycle, 3 year bull market, and the bear we don't know yet. But clearly, there is the cycles are going up over time in duration. So the halvening is not important. Yes, and then there's also, of course, and this is so ignored, that growth is going down over time. So in many parameters, you will make new lows. Like the 200-day moving average or whatever it is, weekly average, or was never broken in the previous cycle, so it will be support now. No, because the growth is going down over time. And we also see clearly on the chart, the Trollor chart, that not only is growth going down over time, undervaluation is going down over time, and overvaluation is going down over time. Everything is going down over time. So very likely, all these things that were support in the previous bear market will prove to fail as support in this bear market. Very important. Yes, what else do we have? Thanks so much all for watching. I can see that the amount of viewers is picking up. The amount of dislikes too. That's okay. The amount of negative comments too, that's okay. But I also see a lot of support and people really valuing my work, and I thank you so much, guys. You really keep me going, and some of you really helped me a lot in staying as rational as possible. Let's see what else we have. Yeah, I asked Joachim Holmer to stop promoting Bitcoin SV everywhere I go. Hey, on my Twitter, even sending personal messages constantly about Bitcoin SV. Here also constantly about Bitcoin SV. Please, yeah, it's okay. You can mention it, but please don't spam the thread with it. I would really appreciate it. Joachim, I know you believe strongly in it, and it's okay to make your point, but please don't do it too much. And the same for LA Matt, who seems to be posting a lot too about SV. Just a few posts, please, not more. Let's see what else we have. What else do we have here? I can't see any interesting questions here. Okay, I'm not gonna go into that. My dream future car is the Lamborghini Performante, the Hurricane Performante Spider. I love that car, and I think it's so beautiful, and I would love to buy it, but I'm not sure that's a good idea. I've bought the Lambo in the previous bear market, and I'm happy I did it. I enjoyed the car very much, but the car really gave me a hell. Everything broke down on it, and it costed me a fortune. For example, like the engine blew up, had to replace the engine. I decided to sell 10 million NXT, diversifying away from crypto, because I still was I had invested 80% into crypto during the bear market. So when the bull market started, I felt like overinvested, and I felt like, okay, I need to diversify some crypto into other things, and you have to enjoy life too, and I decided to sell 10 million NXT to buy a new engine. It costed $50,000. 10 million NXT was worth $15,000. So I did that. But guess how much 10 million NXT was worth at the end of the bull market, only 2 years later? Well, that was $20 million, huh? So by buying that engine for $50,000, I missed an opportunity to make $20 million. Huh? That's crazy, huh? And that's what happens when you buy Lambos during a bear market. So it's much better to buy Lambos during a bull market, or at the end of a bull market, than at the end of a bear market. So that's why I hold off buying another Lambo, and I'm even considering selling the one I have, because owning cars, I think it's more interesting to rent them, especially supercars. But of course, it's a fun toy to have. I'm still conflicted about it. Let's see what else we have. I also have real people that follow my work and strongly disagree and keep on following my work and keep on posting how wrong I am. I think that's also a good sign, huh? Let's see. What else do we have? Yes, interesting, Samo. He says, hey Mark, I agree with you, but I think we will see a pullback in BTC, but with a rise in alts. I think that's very interesting, and a point where I'm thinking a lot about, because in the previous bear market, at the end of the bear market, when Bitcoin dropped from 1,050, that was the top, to 500-600, everything went normal. Bitcoin was gaining in market share. We went to $300 US, and but then something weird happened in the middle of the bear market. Bitcoin started to lose market share to Ripple. Ripple went up a lot, but other alts also were bouncing, and Bitcoin dominance went down in the middle of the bear market. And then at the end of the bear market, when Bitcoin dropped through the floor from $300 US to 155, the bottom, Bitcoin dominance was not at its peak. It was not. And so you would expect that Bitcoin dominance continues to go up the whole way down, as capital is scared, and so they choose the biggest coins, and so they sell smaller coins for bigger coins, and so Bitcoin profits from that and goes down the least. So you would expect that dominance continues to go down, sorry, up. But it didn't happen like that, actually. But the thing is that it was just because of Ripple, because the other coins on average did not go up versus Bitcoin, but on average they also did not go down. You look at Litecoin at the time, and Monero and Dash. Yes, they some lost market share, others won, and on average actually they did not go down. But that was at the last. But the Ripple went up a lot in market share, and therefore Bitcoin overall lost market share at the end of the bear market. And so that's a little bit a very difficult situation today, because I do think we're also there. We're halfway the bear market, and I mean, not in time. In time, we're almost through. But in valuations, I think the last capitulation will happen, will be the biggest shock. And what will happen? Will Bitcoin dominance go up or down? We saw it going up a lot during this bear market, from a low of 25% or so to a high of 60% only a couple weeks back. But what will happen in the future? And I think it's the safest to just keep it stable in your projections, and not expect it to go up, but also not expect it to go down anymore. And expect some coins to pump versus Bitcoin even if the bear market continues. And so that means that Bitcoin Cash or Ethereum or Ripple, probably some bigger coin, I mean, may gain market share in a pump and not give it all back when we do find the bottom. And I think for Bitcoin Cash, for example, the odds are low that it will go down in market share to where it went. It went to only 1.3% market dominance, but I don't think we will see that back, even if Bitcoin makes a new low and Ethereum may also pump from here and then go down again. But I think it's still likely we will see a new bottom. But I think that's especially valid for Bitcoin, and not valid actually for Bitcoin Cash. And even Ethereum may not find a new low. Even when Bitcoin goes to 2,500, I think Ethereum may not break $80 again. And Bitcoin Cash actually is very unlikely to break it again. So, I agree that you have to be very careful with that. And the way to do it, I think maybe is the best that instead of setting your buy orders at a certain price for whatever alt you want to buy, maybe it's better to wait till Bitcoin reaches those prices that you're much more certain of. Like, it, I think it's still likely, not very likely, but also not just maybe. No, I think it's still likely Bitcoin will hit 2,800. That's a new low. But for me, it's so hard to estimate. Where will Bitcoin Cash be then? Or where will be Ethereum? I don't know. I'm doing a best guess, but it's uncertain. So maybe the best strategy there is to just not set buy orders, wait for Bitcoin to reach that price, or for the higher prices, all valid everywhere. And only when Bitcoin reaches price, then you decide to buy that whatever alt you want to buy at whatever price it is. Huh? That may be the better strategy. Let's see what else we have. Yes, I love the project of Olivier Janssens. It's called Free Society. I like it very much. I think the next step in human evolution is to build a society where you don't have a government in the traditional sense, where it enforces its rules with violence. I think it's a bad foundation. I mean, it's a better foundation than the kind of governments we've had before, where power is given to the son or daughter of whoever is ruling. I think democracy is a step forward, where you can elect whoever is ruling you, but you're still being ruled. They still can decide whatever they want and back it up with the threat of violence if you don't comply. That's not really a voluntary society. So I think that what's so difficult is to start such a society. How do you do that? Because you have a lot of competition. These governments and the people that they rule are pretty violent also. And so if you start some kind of independent country next to them, the temptation for them is very hard to come in with an army and take it over. So you need to build an army. This is all very, very complicated. So I think Olivier Janssens has found a very good way to break that. By his approach is to try to buy or lease land from a government, diversify over different locations. So if one government actually breaks the contract and starts to like rule instead of giving a service, starts to like use the threat of violence to get what they want instead of dealing and selling. If you have different locations, you can just basically migrate to the other location and see it as a lost territory. So I think it might be a good approach. I'm very excited to see what's going to happen there. I think this is the kind of future we can build as crypto investors in the future. But this is long ahead. The first objective is to build a crypto stash during this bear market, huh? And then sit on it for a long time and build a crypto economy. Let's see what other questions we have. Why am I so bullish on Bitcoin Cash? Check my videos, just and search my YouTube channel about Bitcoin Cash or BCH, because I've been bullish since it started on the 1st of August 2017. I've made many videos on why, and I still stand behind that. Let's see what else we have. I'm gonna have to end this 1.5 hours, guys. I'm gonna go through the questions that have been posted, but you can stop asking new questions. Let's see. Joachim Holmer, who is promoting Bitcoin SV, says, I'm a nice guy, but I'm a trader and I don't care about the fundamentals. That's really not true. I'm not a trader, I'm an investor. I invest for the long term, for years, when I buy something, and the fundamentals are the first thing I look at. That's what I really care about. Is fundamentals is adoption in the end? Like, are they succeeding in getting adoption? But of course, I've learned that that doesn't mean actual users. It could also mean other developers in the early phases that building on top of it, huh? Or but fundamentals is also about ideology. What's the vision? Huh? What do you stand for? What's the project? Huh? That's why I like Bitcoin Cash very much, huh? because I think private currencies are actually very controversial. They were forbidden by all governments around the world. If you would try to launch your own private currency, you would be jailed. And that's very recently. At the end of the 90s, that was still the case. People got jailed and their companies got confiscated. All the assets got confiscated for doing that. It was forbidden by law. That's why Bitcoin at the early days was so risky, because it was very likely. And they actually considered to arrest the developers and jail them. It's actually a surprise that it didn't happen, because that was what everybody expected in the early days of Bitcoin. It didn't happen because it was launched right after the financial crisis collapsed, like the economy really collapsed, and and it was a shock to the whole world that that could happen in 2008, that all the big banks could go broke at the same time, that the government needed to print so much money to bail them out, and also that the economy came to a standstill, like international trade dropped by 80%. That's a standstill that was never seen the past 100 years. Only during the Great Depression of the 30s did that happen before. So it was a real shock. And the first time that the majority of rulers started to see that that fiat monetary system may not be the best system in the world, because, wow, they need to print a lot of money to bail out banks. And what's going to lead to that? Like, how much inflation will that cause? Huh? So they... I think that's why they decided not to imprison the developers of Bitcoin, huh? Because they were, for the first time in history, willing to let an experiment run, something that will compete with their own currency and will take away a big source of their income in the long term. But it does, it would be a better world. And sometimes I do think that leaders, you have good leaders and bad leaders, huh? And you have people that destroy and people that build. And it's the same with people that get elected in office, huh? And sometimes they make good decisions. And that was one of the few good decisions they made, not to use violence there and let it just happen. And that's what happened. And so we're very fortunate to have private currencies today. That's thanks to the financial crisis and thanks to some genius launching that in such a way that he could not be found. And it became morally a difficult thing to do for the governments to clamp down on it. So now we have private currencies, but the war is not won, guys. Like, governments is a combination of many, many, many people. Like, actually half of the population makes their money via the government. in Europe, for example. So half the population is really promoting the system and stands behind the system and wants the system to stay in place, which means, yes, they stand behind taxes and high taxes, and they also stand behind the monetary system where the government gets their income via printing money, via inflation. And that's actually half of their income. So half of the population stand behind it. And many government agencies fully stand behind that, like the CIA or the Fed or the, like, these people are directly paid by printed money, or teachers, government schools, like many people directly stand behind it and will fight private currencies because they know, either consciously or unconsciously, that it threatens their source of income, their livelihood. So they will try to sabotage crypto left and right. They will not, at least not until today, outright outlaw it like they still do in the East, in China, and where it's a much more autocratic government still. They will just outright ban it and still jail people. But in the West, they're less autocratic, so they won't ban it. But they do have agencies that are that actually are in the business of using violence against people who threaten the government. So I do think this is still happening in crypto, and I think that they successfully succeeded in hijacking Bitcoin BTC. Successfully hijacked it, and the people that make the decisions about Bitcoin make decisions in such a way that it's tempers its growth. It's not destroying it from one day to the other, but it's not allowed to grow. And it literally is not allowed to grow. They cannot increase, they are not increasing the block size, and as a consequence, transaction fees go up a lot, and it really gives a very bad impression for people that want to enter this industry to see that it's not competitive, that the market leader is not competitive. Like, people have to pay $5 or $10 for a transaction. That's not a threat to the current banking system. People like free stuff. They like free transactions. And in the bank, it's a free transaction. At least if you do a domestic transaction, which is 99% of the transactions, it's free. In Europe, it's free. People love free stuff. And they all people don't really count the long term. People prefer a free currency, even if it drops 5% in value every year. If you can do free transactions, they prefer that over one that goes up 100% per year, but you have to pay $5 per transaction. People don't think ahead, so the masses will choose the first one, even though it's the not such a good choice. So I think this is what's happening, and that's why I love Bitcoin Cash, because Bitcoin Cash needs to, like, they do this with Bitcoin because Bitcoin has such a strong brand. If people gonna adopt anything that come new to the crypto industry, they will take Bitcoin, not Ethereum, not Ripple, not Dash, not Monero, not Bitcoin Cash yet. Because they always take the leader, the one that's the biggest, but also Bitcoin has the brand and the other ones don't. So they've heard like 10 times in their life, or maybe 50 times or 30 times in their life the past few years about Bitcoin, but they never heard about Ethereum. So when they come into the industry, they will buy Bitcoin. But when they see that actually Bitcoin is actually not so great, it's actually costs quite a lot of money to do a transaction, and on top, like, they are like hindered to do so. So that's why I think, like, we cannot let that strong brand destroy itself, because this is our way to get the masses to adopt crypto. It's via the Bitcoin brand, not via the Ethereum brand, because Bitcoin is built. It's, you know how much that would cost to have like 5% or 10% of the population know your brand? You know how much money that costs? Like, Bitcoin has gotten that already, has already paid that expense. So letting the brand go down the drain because it has been hijacked by probably some government is not okay. It's a very bad idea. It might actually slow down the whole crypto industry for decades. So you really have to keep that brand alive. And Bitcoin Cash does that by having forked off Bitcoin and being a fork of Bitcoin, having the same history, having the same coin holders. That's luckily how it's built, cryptocurrency. You can fork it. So and this is a very strong weapon that we have, huh? Yes, you can dominate whoever can add code to it. And that's what's happened. Like in Bitcoin, they kicked out the other developers that did not agree with the agenda with violence, by just removing them from the login access. And that's what's happened. And so, but what they cannot avoid is that you fork the project and you continue where they took over. And that's what Bitcoin Cash did. And so it continues the Bitcoin project. It got a lot of damage, but it does the job well. It's free transactions with a 21 million limit. And yeah, I think it's very important to continue to build this project. And it may make a big difference for the whole crypto industry. Let's see what else we have. Yeah, Joachim, too many posts about SVIA. Next time, I'm gonna kick you off this chat. If you do that again, I will not allow you anymore in. The chat should not be dominated by Bitcoin SV all the time. Let's see what else we have. All right, what else? Fernand, yeah, I addressed that. Cryptomedius, nice to see you. He asks, what is my opinion on Tether and Bitfinex now? Yeah, I think Tether is in serious trouble and under attack. Many people think that they are frauds, and that's certainly possible. But I think we have a combination here of governments also liking confiscating assets. They do that, and they did that here too, stealing the assets of Tether, and so Tether is in trouble because they. Well, that's typical. You know, the thieves, they take the weak players. And Tether was, and Bitfinex are a weak player because they are not being kosher themselves. They try to bail out themselves. Bitfinex had some losses and then they borrow a piece of the Tether dollars to bail themselves out. The government sees these things and they see a weakling and they come in and they take it all away, because they have an excuse now, like, hey, you're doing something illegal. Well, it's all ours now. So that's what they did here. And the assets of Tether are probably lost to the government or a big piece of it. And so that's not coming back. And so a run on the bank is likely or a sudden default. And that will probably, that usually happens when the market corrects a lot. It's the same in the stock market. When do the Ponzi's get revealed? When you get a very strong stock market correction, then only then the Ponzi get revealed, because only then people want their money. Only then people want fiat. Only then people sell their assets and they want to see fiat. And only then the one that does not, the emperor that has no clothes, has to admit that they don't have it and that they have to default. And that's what happens with Barney Madoff in the 2008 crisis. The $50 billion fund was empty. There was nothing in it. And very likely will happen here too. And that will cause a deeper crash, because that news gets revealed right when the market is going down. And so that's like very bad news that is real. And it gets added to the media and you have more selling, and so a deeper bottom. So that's why I think this is the perfect storm that's waiting for crypto to make a new fiat bottom. That I think, and I'm thinking more and more like, yeah, I don't know, but yeah. Like it's not so likely when you make a new bottom that it's only a little bit lower than the previous bottom. That's not likely. Like if Bitcoin breaks 3,050, it's actually not likely that we will see a bottom of 2,800, 2,900, because it's a new low. And new low is usually like 50% lower than the previous low. And so that means that even 2,500 is not so likely. 2,000 is more likely. And so, yeah, I'm thinking about these things more to set my to set my buy-in plan. Rudolf, how to get your ex-girlfriend back by moving forward? And of course, you should apologize about what you did wrong and see if she's open to it. But usually, it's by changing yourself. If she was the better one, and if you regret, then probably you need to become the better one too. And only then you make a chance to get her back. And that means improving yourself on different levels. Intellectually, professionally, your game, the way you treat girls, but also moving forward. And don't be desperate. Don't chase. Start to see other girls, and start, and you will become better that way. And then you can still contact her later, but from a different approach. And maybe she'll be open it, maybe not. But it's by moving forward. Let's see what else we have. Well, this keeps going. The longest live chat ever. What kind of companies do you plan to build around BCH? I don't know yet. Still thinking about that. Thanks for asking. Great question. Yeah, Guillermo is right. You should research a lot before buying a used supercar. The issues with your Lambo were known to happen with those kilometers. Very, very true. And I have the impression with girls that come of age, there are also certain problems that tend to pop up. Of course, it's true with guys that come of age too, huh? I will never buy again a used supercar that's like 5 or 10 years old. Never again. Yeah, that was a big mistake. It's only interesting if you want to drive a little bit of kilometers, but if you want to drive a lot of kilometers like me, don't buy an old supercar. That's the worst thing you can do, huh? Yes, it's much cheaper than a new car, a supercar, but the maintenance is tremendous. The things that break down cost a fortune. You're better off buying a new one because you will lose the same amount of money in depreciation, but you will have a pleasant experience because the thing won't break down all the time on you. Maybe there's something to say about that, about girls too, huh? Do you have any other investments than crypto? Not anymore. Yeah, fiat, huh? Fiat is also an investment. US dollars and euros. Please stop posting questions, guys. I'm gonna close the chat soon in 10 minutes. Will you go in 100% if Bitcoin reaches 5,800? I decided not to go 100% into Bitcoin Cash, even if it reaches $50, which will be my last buy-in price. Yeah, I think it's the wise thing to do. I've said many times why, so check my other videos. I will go 90% maximum. So would you rather choose Bitcoin or quality altcoins for the next bull market? When if you want to make massive gains, this is a very evident that you should not be in Bitcoin if you want to make massive gains. The upwards potential is much, much, much lower in Bitcoin than, for example, Ethereum or Bitcoin Cash. Eh? So and many, many smaller projects have much higher upwards potential. But the most important thing is that Bitcoin has changed, its fundamentals has changed, and this is very, very dangerous. It used to be cheap to transact Bitcoin, now it's expensive. It used to be fast, now it's slow sometimes. Eh? Like now, like you want to send the transaction, it can take like 12 hours before it starts confirming. And if you didn't pay a high enough fee, it can just never confirm and you have to redo it again. Like this is a very different way of the way the coin works. So this has changed. So actually, it's not about making money anymore here. It's about not losing money, huh? Like a market leader, good position because it has the network effect to its advantage. But you do can fuck it up even with a network effect in your advantage if you make big mistakes. And I do think Bitcoin is doing that. But there are many in the past that have made big mistakes, even though they had the network advantage to their advantage. Yeah? So it would not be the first one that fucks it up completely and loses the market completely. So I don't think Bitcoin actually should be invested in Bitcoin BTC, even not during this bear market, because the fundamentals have weakened so much. It's just dangerous to do so. But investing in the crypto industry is still a great idea. And then you can just look at the market leaders after Bitcoin because they have good fundamentals, huh? Like Ethereum and Bitcoin Cash. Let's see. Let's see what else we have. My God, Joachim, way too many posts about BSV. Not cool, man. I asked you several times already to not do that in my other public channels, and now you do it again here. You also don't help, you don't convince people by spamming them with the same information. It's not a good strategy. Same as you don't you're gonna not gonna get your girl back, or you're not gonna convince a girl by calling her all the time. No, eh? No, she can see you're desperate, and she can see you're chasing, and it's not pleasant, and you just repulse her more and more. Eh? It's the same here. Yeah. Let's see what else we have. We're at the end of the chat. Thanks so much all for joining. I really appreciate it. Biggest longest chat, most people that joined. Also my last video, if you haven't seen it yet, at 4,000 views. I'm very, very proud of it, and I think it's a very good case I make on showing you the way I plan to invest, but also the case I make why I think it's extremely probable that this breakout will fail, and we will test the bottom. And it's even likely, but less likely, but also likely that we will see a new low and why. So please rewatch my previous video where I say I'm ready for dump. Please rewatch that or watch it if you haven't seen it yet. It's really worth it. Leave some likes on it and some comments on it because I think everybody should see that. Thanks so much all for joining and I wish you all a great Sunday. A little view of the place here. Very beautiful. I'm in Kenya, Nairobi. There are clouds in the sky, but usually it's very warm here. But the rain season will start, and then it's a lot of rain, but it's very warm here. Have a great Sunday.